गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे माय लेक्चर इज ऑन डाइल्यूट सॉल्यूशंस एंड कॉलिगेटिव प्रॉपर्टीज। इन द प्रीवियस क्लास रिलेटेड टू दिस लेसन वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट डाइल्यूट सॉल्यूशंस, व्हाट इज द डेफिनेशन ऑफ डाइल्यूट सॉल्यूशंस, व्हाट इज सॉल्वेंट, व्हाट इज सॉल्यूट, व्हाट इज हेनरी लॉ, व्हाट इज राउट लॉ। These all our topics already discussed in the previous topic, that is dilute solutions. For continuation of this topic, now we are going to discuss about colligative properties. Colligative properties. So in this topic we are discussing about four type of colligative properties. So let us start the colligative properties topic. So first of all, what is the definition of the colligative properties? What is the definition of the colligative properties? Colligative properties are which depends upon number of solute particles present in the solution. Number of solute particles present in the solution, not on the nature of the solute. Those properties called as a colligative properties. Colligative properties nothing but the properties which depends upon the number of particles of the solute. Particles of the solute present in that solution. Means colligative properties directly proportional to, directly depends upon the particles of the solute present in the solution. So there is a connection between the colligative properties and particles of the solute, not solvent, only colligative property depends upon the solute. So depends upon the particles of the solute, colligative properties are four types. One is relative lowering in vapor pressure. Means relative lowering in vapor pressure by the adding or removing of particles of the solute, we can lower the vapor pressure of the solution. Next, elevation in boiling point. This is one of the colligative property. Elevation in boiling point means you have to increase the boiling point of the solution with adding of solute particles. Next, third property is depression is freezing point. Depression means you have to decrease the freezing point of the solution by the adding of solute particles. Last one, fourth one is osmotic pressure. Means osmotic pressure by the adding of solute particles, we can create the osmotic pressure. So these are the colligative properties which are depends on the solute particles. So before going to the colligative properties, we have to know the what is vapor pressure, what is boiling point, what is freezing point, what is osmolysis. These are the important terminology you have to know here. So first of all, before going to the colligative properties, we have to know the what is vapor pressure. What is vapor pressure? Vapor pressure is nothing but, for example, you take the solution, in that solution there are solvent particles are there, solute particles are there. At certain temperature, pressure, the solvent particles and solute particles exerted the pressure on the surface of the liquid. That pressure is called as a vapor pressure. For example, if you take the solution, at given temperature and pressure, when the solution containing solvent particles or solute particles are converted into vapors, these vapors are exerted the partial pressure on the liquid state. So there is a dynamic equilibrium exists between the vapor phase and liquid phase. This type of pressure is called as a vapor pressure. So this is the definition of the vapor pressure. For example, if you take the to create the vapor pressure, the solvent or solute must be volatile. One of these substance must be volatile. Volatile substance means the substance which easily evaporate, the substance which creates vapors, the type of substance called as a volatile. For example, in a solution, volatile solvent means solvent easily evaporates, easily converted into liquid to vapors, liquid to vapors. Non-volatile means it is not converted into liquid to vapors, means it is not going to be evaporation. Okay, you have to identify the what is the volatile and non-volatile. Volatile means easily they converted into liquid to vapors. Non-volatile means they do not evaporate to the liquid to vapors. So if you create the vapor pressure on the surface of the solution, one of the solvent or solute must be volatile, then only vapor pressure will be created. So in this case, first, if for example, if you take a closed container, in that container you take the pure solvent, means it has only pure solvent, means for example, if you take water, only water, not salt water. Pure solvent means only one type of particles only available in that solution. So when if pure solvent taken in a closed container at a given temperature and pressure, the surface of the solution is occupied by only solvent molecules. So the evaporation rate is gradually high, is gradually increases to high. So because of the surface of the solution is occupied by only solvent molecules, so they can easily evaporate, that vapors create the partial pressure on surface of the solution surface and creates the vapor pressure. So vapor pressure of the pure solvent is called as a P0A. So A means let us consider pure solvent, that is A. So total pressure of the solvent or total pressure of the solution is PT is equal to P0A, means there is no solute present in this solution, so only pure solvent. So for pure solvent, the vapor pressure is PT is equal to P0A. Let us take the second case. Vapor pressure of volatile solvent and volatile solute. So let us take a solution in a closed container. In that solution, solvent is volatile in nature, solute is volatile in nature. This means both are volatile. They are easily converted into vapors. They are easily converted into vapors, means they are easily evaporates. So when you take the solvent and solute, so in that solution, the surface of the solution is occupied by solute vapors and solvent vapors, means solute particles and solvent particles. At a given temperature and pressure, these solute particles and solvent liquid particles both are converted into vapors, means they create the solute vapors and solvent vapors. Solute vapors and solvent. These both vapors again create the partial pressure on the surface of the solution. So they create two types of vapor pressures. Vapor pressure of the solvent and vapor pressure of the solute. So let us take, for example, if you take solvent, let us take A solvent, let us take solute B. So vapor pressure of the solvent is equal to be PA, vapor pressure of the solute is equal to PB. It is not pure, it is not a pure, it is solvent is mixed with solute, we cannot consider it as a pure solution. So it is not pure, that's why you take vapor pressure of solvent is PA, vapor pressure of solute is PB. So total vapor pressure of the solution in the closed container. So we have to calculate the total vapor pressure for this solution, that is PT means P total is equal to PA plus PB. So this is the total vapor pressure of volatile solvent and volatile solute which are present in the solution. Next, third case, vapor pressure of volatile solvent and non-volatile solute. So here let us take container. In that container we have take the solution. In that solution there is a volatile solvent. We have to take the volatile solvent, but solute is non-volatile. Solvent is volatile, solute is non-volatile, means solute does not create the vapors, so does not create the vapor pressure. So only solvent molecules only create the vapors or only create the vapor pressures. So here, what is the problem here? In the solution, in the closed container, the surface of the solution is occupied by both solvent and solute particles. But only solvent liquid particles are converted into vapors, not solute particles, because solute particles are non-volatile. Means the surface occupied by the solvent molecules that are converted into vapors, those vapors only create the vapor pressure. So solute vapor pressure here going to be zero, solvent vapor pressure is going to be PA. So vapor pressure of the solvent is equal to PA, vapor pressure of the solute PB is equal to zero, because solute is a non-volatile. If it is non-volatile, so there is no vapor pressure. So total vapor pressure of the solution PT is equal to PB, PA plus PB. Here PB is equal to zero. So almost the solution vapor pressure is equal to vapor pressure of the solvent. So PT is equal to PA. This is the another case. So here in a solution you have to take different type of solvent and solutes. Depends upon the volatile in nature, the vapor pressure of the solution will be changes. So then we go for the colligative properties of the solute particles. First property we are going to discuss is that relative lowering in vapor pressure. So relative lowering in vapor pressure means we have to decrease the vapor pressure of the solution by the adding of non-volatile solute. Means lowering in vapor pressure depends upon the non-volatile solute particles which we are going to be add. So adding of non-volatile solute to the solution, it leads to lower the vapor pressure of the solution. Because in a closed container, if you take the volatile solvent and non-volatile solute, so the surface vapor pressure depends upon the particles which are occupied by the surface of the solutions. Here two types of particles are occupied by surface of the solution, but only volatile solvent particles only create the vapor pressure, not non-volatile solute particles. So by adding the non-volatile solute particles to the solution, the surface occupied by the solute molecules is increases. Means automatically the solvent particles are going to be decreases. When the volatile solvent particles are decreases, so vapor pressure is also decreases. So by the adding of non-volatile solute particles, we can decrease the vapor pressure. This is again depends upon the adding of solute particles. So relative lowering in vapor pressure is a pure colligative properties, because lowering in vapor pressure is depends upon the adding of non-volatile solute. So let us take a volatile solvent, non-volatile solvent. So vapor pressure of the solvent is PA, vapor pressure of the solute PB is going to be easily zero. So P total pressure going to be is equal to PA. So PA is equal to P naught A into XA according to Raoult's law. PA is equal to P naught A into XA. P naught A is pure vapor pressure of the solvent. XA is mole fraction of the solute. So when after this mathematical conversion, it is going to be converted into previous equation. So P naught A minus PA by P naught A is equal to 1 minus XA. So by the adding of solute particles, we can decrease the vapor pressure. So we have to calculate the amount of solute present in the solute solution. So by the equation of this one, we can calculate the amount of solute present in the solution. So this is regarding about relative lowering in vapor pressure. Next to colligative properties, elevation in boiling point. So what is the first of all, you have to know the definition of the boiling point. So the temperature of a liquid at which its vapor pressure becomes equal to atmospheric pressure is called as boiling point. Means if the solution, the temperature at which the vapor pressure is equal to be atmospheric pressure, that point of temperature is called as a boiling point. So let us derive the equation for elevation in boiling point. Elevation in boiling point means we have to increase the boiling point by the adding of non-volatile solutes. Let us take a solution. In that solution, there is a volatile solvent and non-volatile solute. So when we add the non-volatile solute particles to the solution, the surface of the solution is occupied by both solvent and solute particles. Here vapor pressure increases, automatically the atmospheric pressure is also increases. So if we increase the vapor pressure, the atmospheric pressure is also increases. So here by adding of non-volatile solute particles, the vapor pressure is gradually decreases. When the vapor pressure gradually decreases means when the liquid is converted into vapors, we need a certain temperature. So by adding of non-volatile solute particles, the liquid particles are converted into vapors the temperature is going to be very towards very high temperatures. Means by adding of non-volatile solute particles, the vapor pressure going to be very low. When the vapor pressure is very low, automatically the boiling point is gradually increases. Means by the adding of the solute particles, non-volatile solute particles, we can increase the boiling point of the solution. When a non-volatile solute added to the liquid, vapor pressure of the liquid is reduced. Hence, it must be heated to higher temperature in order to that its vapor pressure becomes to atmospheric pressure. This means that addition of non-volatile solute to a liquid elevates its boiling point. So, by the graph we can easily explain the elevation in boiling point. Let us take a graph, vapor pressure versus temperature. The first line, so that is the atmospheric pressure, that is 1 atmosphere. In the pure solvent, solvent means pure solvent, in the pure solvent takes, if we try to increase the temperature, automatically vapor pressure increases. That vapor pressure is going to be equal at this point. When the take solution, means we have to add the non-volatile solute to the solvent, that is going to be solution. When the adding of non-volatile solute, so here this is the second graph. Temperature increases, automatically this is the graph of the solution. So T naught B is the pure solvent boiling point. TB is the solution after the adding of non-volatile solute particles. This is TB is the boiling point of the solution. So let TB, T naught B, the boiling point of pure solvent. TB is the boiling point of the solution. So the increase in boiling point delta TB is equal to TB minus T naught B is known as elevation in boiling point. So for dilute solution, the elevation in boiling point is directly proportional to the molar concentration of the solute particles. Yes or no? So elevation in boiling point depends upon the number of non-volatile particles, non-volatile solute particles added to that solution. So it depends upon the how much molar concentration which we are going to added, we decided the elevation in boiling point. Means elevation in boiling point is directly proportional to the molar concentration of the solution, means molality. So delta TB is equal to KB into M. Here KB is molar elevation constant, and it is also called as ebullioscopic constant. Ebullioscopic constant. So this is the, so by the equation of this one, we can easily identify the how much amount of non-volatile solute particles we are added to the solution. We can easily determine by this equation. M is equal 1000 into W2 by M2 by W1. So by this equation we can easily determine the molar mass of the solute which is present in the solution. So this is W constant. This is the second property of the colligative properties. Next, third property is depression in freezing point. Depression in freezing point. What? Let us know the definition of the freezing point. The temperature at which there exists an equilibrium between solid state vapors pressures and liquid vapor pressure are equal, called as a freezing point. Freezing point means at the temperature at which there is a equilibrium exist between the solid state and liquid state. At that equilibrium state, the vapor pressure of the solid phase and vapor pressure of the liquid phase are equal. At that point is called as freezing point. So when you take a non-volatile solid is added to the solvent, the vapor pressure automatically decreases. So when the vapor pressure automatically decreases, it is lower the freezing point. Freezing point means it can easily lower the temperature of the solution. If temperature of the solution. So let us take one graph. In that graph, again vapor pressure versus temperature. The first case, we take first pure solvent, means pure solvent in frozen means solid state. As the temperature increases at a certain point, it is converted into liquid solvent. So this is the first graph. The second graph, if you add the non-volatile solid to the solvent, so this is the second graph. This is the second graph. So by the graph, the depression in freezing point depends upon the, again, number of non-volatile solute molecules rather than nature of the solute. So it is obviously it is going to be again colligative properties. So T naught F is the freezing point of the pure solvent, and TF is the freezing point of the non-volatile solute dissolved in the solution. So delta TF is the difference, decrease in difference between the freezing point, that is delta T naught F is equal to T naught F minus T of is known as depression in freezing point. So for dilute solutions, again depression in freezing point is directly proportional to the mole concentration of the solution. So delta TF is directly proportional to M, means molality. So delta TF is equal to KF into M. Here KF is called as molal depression constant, molal depression constant, or cryoscopic constant, or cryoscopic constant. So some of the examples of the freezing point depression, the freezing point of seawater at below 0 degrees, it is remains as a liquid. Freezing point of pure water, it is caused by salt that are dissolved in water. So in seawater at 0 degrees remains as liquid because of seawater contains non-volatile solute particles as salts. So at below 0 degrees Celsius, seawater is in the form of liquid. This is the best example of depression in freezing point by the adding of the salts. Another example of freezing point is vodka or ethanol in water. So when we adding the ethanol means we can add to the water, the freezing point is lower than the water. So higher than the pure ethanols. So it is also best example for us, depression in freezing point. So these are the examples for the depression in, what is the use of freezing point, depression in freezing point. When the cold areas where the temperature range from 0 to minus 15 Celsius degrees, sodium chloride is is added to the freezing point of the water to prevent a build up ice. So in order to lower the freezing point of the water in cold areas, means Atlantic and Arctic snow areas, so we can prevent the buildup of the ice. Okay, next, if the temperature is below 18 Celsius degrees temperature, so calcium chloride is used instead of sodium chloride in the melt of ice on the roads. So because of the calcium chloride dissociates into ions, causing the greater in depression point of the water. Next, so if you take the radiator in cold and areas, the radiator water actually at 0 degree Celsius temperature, it is going to be, water is going to be converted into solid. So to remove the conversion of liquid into solid of the water in cold radiators of the cars, we can use ethylene glycol plus water. So it prevents the freezing of the radiator during the cold areas. Means in the cold seasons, in the cold areas, in the cars, we are using the radiators. In that radiators, we are only use the pure water. But the pure water at 0 degree Celsius converted into solid. So we have to decrease the freezing point. But water freezes at zero. So we have to decrease. Means we have to go into the minuses. So for to get the freezing of water, we have to add the ethylene glycol to the water. So it cannot going to be converted into solid at 0 degrees Celsius temperatures by the adding of ethylene glycol. So these are the best examples of the freezing point depression. Next, lost property is osmolysis or osmotic pressure. So before going to that, we have to know the definition of the osmosis. So simple definition. Here let us take two chambers. One is you have to take as one chamber is called as a salt water, means it is a solution. Means here solvent and solute particles are mixed. That solution is called as a salt water. This part, green part, is called as a solution. From right side, if you take pure solvent, means fresh water, pure water, water means solvent, pure solvent. Here is pure solvent, green side is solution. So water, pure water and solution, between these two different types of pure solvent and solution, we have to put the semi-permeable membrane. This semi-permeable membrane is allowed to pass the pure solvent water particles, passing through the semi-permeable membrane. So here, pure water molecule, water means pure solvent has the higher concentration. Salt water means it has the lower concentration. So when the flow of pure solvent from high concentration to lower concentration through a semi-permeable membrane, until the concentration of the solvent in the both chambers becomes to equal, this process is known as osmosis. So when we allow the pure water, means pure solvent water, to this semi-permeable membrane, so it is slowly flow from high concentration to low concentrations. Means it is going to be, when it is going to be stopped, the solvent concentration in the both chambers going to be equal, then only the flow of the solvent is going to be stopped. So this process, this phenomena is called as osmosis. So here, what is the osmotic pressure? Here this is the important point we are going to discuss in this point. So the net flow of the solvent can be stopped stopped by, applied by the some external pressure over the solution is called as the osmotic pressure. So here we take the pure solvent and another side we take the solution. So solvent particles are slowly flowing towards solution. So to stop the flow of the pure solvent, we have to use the external pressure on the solution. So by the using of external pressure on the solution, we have to stop the flow of the pure solvent. This pressure, this external pressure is called as a osmotic pressure. This external pressure is called as a osmotic pressure. It is represented with pi. So according to, so this phenomena is is delivered by the Van't Hoff. So he delivered an equation, Van't Hoff equation. According to Van't Hoff equation, pi means osmotic pressure is directly proportional to the concentration of the solute. Directly proportional to the concentration of the solute means and temperature. So osmotic pressure is equal to C means concentration of the solution, R means solution constant, T is temperature. Pi is equal to M is molality. Concentration we have to calculate in molality and R into T. So this is the Van't Hoff equation. So when you try to identify the how much of solute particles present in the solution, we have to know the another equation, that is pi is equal W means weight, RT by M means molar mass into V. This is the definition to determine the amount of solute present in the solution. So again, osmotic pressure is again depends upon the number of particles, solute particle present in the solution. So according to Van't Hoff equation, the osmotic pressure depends only upon the molar concentration of the solute, is again independent of the nature of the solute. So this is Van't Hoff equation. So osmosis is the best examples also have to discuss here. The best example, transport of water in plants. So when the plants or the plants roots are dipped in the soil, so in that soil, if the plants absorb the water, that process is called as osmosis. This is the best example for the osmosis. Next, to function of the kidneys. So what is the function of the kidneys? Purify the blood. So by the absorption of the water, from the blood cells, it can easily purify the blood. So function of kidneys is one of the best example for osmolysis, osmotic pressure. So by this last colligative property, osmotic pressure, we end the colligative properties topic. So in this topic we are discuss the most important four types of colligative properties. One is relative lowering in vapor pressure. Second one is elevation in boiling point. Third one is depression in freezing point. Fourth one is osmotic pressure. So these all colligative properties, by the adding of the solute, non-volatile solute particles, they are going to be changes. So these all properties again depends upon the number of solute particles present in the solution, not nature of the solute. So thank you.